sounds too blurry. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. No power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward?
Strength. Good morning, church family. Let's pray together. Dear Lord, last night as I was reading my Bible, you provided me with great comfort from the book of Psalm. In this book, I found countless assurances of your everlasting love for us. I was reminded that it's you, Lord, who determines the number of the stars. And it's you, Lord, who gives the stars their names. And it doesn't end there. You are the one who heals the brokenhearted, and it's you who binds up our wounds. As we gather here today to worship and receive your word, I want us to take a moment to remember who you are. You, O Lord, are a gracious and powerful God, and your mercies are new every morning. And you are good to all. You promise us that you will draw near to all who call on you, to all who call on you in truth. Lord, would you draw near to each and every one of us sitting here today and those who are at home watching online? God, I know you see us, you hear us, you know exactly what our needs are right now in this very moment. Please draw near to those who are crying out to you for comfort, for healing, for a peace that passes all understanding. Whether we're living through a season of celebration or a season of mourning, let us seek you first in every season of our life, for your kingdom is an everlasting one. What an honor it is to praise you like the way we did today, until in your perfect timing, you call us home to be with you. Thank you for the sweetness and perfect beauty of an eternal life in heaven with you that awaits us all. In your precious name we pray, amen.
Before you sit down, why don't you turn to the people sitting around you and greet one another. Well, good morning once again, especially to those of you young adults, young people. This morning we're going to look at the demoiselle crane. This is a demoiselle crane. It is the smallest of all of the cranes. And in the summer months, demoiselle cranes live in the northern parts of Russia, where they raise their chicks. But right before winter starts, they undertake one of the most difficult of all the bird migrations. They fly south from Russia down to India, where the winters are much warmer. But to get there, they have to fly over the Himalaya Mountains. And to do that, they have to fly at altitudes of up to 26,000 feet, 5 miles up, where the air is freezing and very thin. And every year, many demoiselle cranes die from the cold or starvation during their journey. And still others are attacked by golden eagles who wait for them every year. But most finish the migration and land throughout India. And one place they spend the winter is near the village of Kichan. And Kichan is a small village in a rural part of India. 100 years ago, Kichan was a very wealthy, busy city, but many of its merchants eventually moved away to the larger cities, and today it's kind of a sleepy, relatively poor community in India. Now, one of the people who had moved away was Ratanlal Malu, who had moved away but then had to return in order to take care of his aging mother. With lots of time on his hands, Ratanlal would often spend time feeding the pigeons and squirrels behind his house. But one day, he found several large black and white birds that he had never seen before feeding with the pigeons. And when he asked his neighbors what they were, he was told they were demoiselle cranes spending the winter here. Ratanlal immediately fell in love with these birds. He continued feeding them, and gradually more began to show up. By the end of winter, 80 were regularly coming to his yard wanting to be fed. But at the end of winter, they all flew back north. But the next year, over 150 demoiselle cranes returned to his yard. And the numbers kept growing. But as they did, local dogs began to attack the birds, and Ratanlal knew he needed to not only feed them, but to protect them as well. So he asked the village council to donate some land on the outskirts of the village, large enough for all the cranes. And then he asked several businesses in the village to donate money so he could build a fence around the area to keep the dogs and other predators out. And in the end, Ratanlal was able to get the land and the fence that he wanted to feed and protect the cranes that he had fallen in love with. And then he went to the local farmers and asked them if they would donate some grain so he could feed his beloved cranes, and they said yes. Well, over the years, the demoiselle cranes must have told their friends in northern Russia about the crane sanctuary in Kichan, India, because what started out as a small bird feeding project now sees 30,000 demoiselle cranes every winter. Now, Ratanlal passed away several years ago, but others in the village have taken on his task of caring for the birds. Every year, people living in and around Kichan give or buy 300,000 pounds of grain to feed the cranes at a cost of over $100,000. And the question that comes to my mind is, why? Why would all these villagers invest so much time and effort and money to care for birds, which give them absolutely nothing in return? Well, the answer is simply that they love these birds. The people in the village of Kichan have fallen in love with their demoiselle cranes, and they find joy in caring for them. You know, I can think of another relationship like this where there's this huge outpouring of love and care onto people who have not earned it, who've done nothing to deserve it. And that is the relationship between you and me and our Heavenly Father. The Bible talks about that relationship. It says, "Lord God, you treat us with kindness day after day, and you rescue us." And then it tells us why. It says, "The Lord your God is with you. He will show you how much he loves you and how happy he is with you." In other words, God is caring for us constantly, not because we've earned it or deserve it, but simply because he loves us. Sometimes we get it in our heads that God is some angry person in the sky and that we need to work hard to make him love us, but that is a false impression. The God of the Bible loves us, period. So here comes the punchline. This is the part that I'd like you to remember. The demoiselle cranes are cared for by the people of Kichan simply because they're loved. And God showers you and me with unearned kindness and care every day simply because he loves us. All right, let me pray for you. Father, I ask that you would watch over these young people here at Crossroads and that you would raise them up to be adults who will love you and trust you with all of their hearts. Thank you, Father. Amen. And the children who are in fifth grade and younger, you are dismissed to Discovery Land. If you don't know where to go, Auntie Teresa is at the back and she'll help you find your room.
From north to to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified.
Good morning. For those of you that don't know me, my name's Craig Matsuda, and I think we've been attending Crossroads from the second year when we were at Tribeca Hills High School. So the first time I heard that song, it truly convicted me. Christ be magnified. Isn't that our desire, for Christ to be magnified in us? How wonderful would it be if people saw Christ magnified in us? I'm sure that you know people, and it might be one of you, that Christ is magnified from the altar of their life. Christ is magnified in them. The question I ask myself, is Christ magnified in me? Is Christ magnified in you? Are we all in for Jesus? Are we fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ? Cody Carnes, who was the author of the song, he says what frames a life of devotion in worship to Christ, that he wrote that a life of devotion and worship to Christ is to be faithful to God, no matter the circumstance. Not to bow to idols, those things that hold our attention, and to hold on to the truths of the Word of God, the Bible. I have a little disclaimer before. This message has come from many different sources, through my notes from devotions, messages, studies, songs, and I apologize if I have taken some of your thoughts and added them into this message. I will acknowledge that these words are not my thoughts, but I believe they are inspired by the Word of God. When Kev asked me to speak, I had a different message in mind that I was going to speak on, but this song, as I said, really resonated in me. Christ be magnified. Was Christ magnified in me? I really couldn't answer that question affirmatively to say I was a fully devoted follower of Christ, that every second of my life, it was focused on him. So let's reflect on what frames a life of devotion and worship to Christ. Faith is putting your trust in God and having confidence that he will fulfill his promise. Hebrews 11:1, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. Let's look at some heroes of faith. In response to God's promise of countless descendants, Abram believed the Lord. Paul wrote in Romans 4:20 through 21, no one belief made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Daniel was frequently pushed to compromise his faith, but he didn't do it. The book of Daniel records Daniel's faithful decisions and their results. Well-known choices include insisting on eating a healthy diet, worshiping God rather than avoiding the fiery furnace, and praying to God rather than avoiding the lion's den. It's also noted in Daniel 3 about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They trusted in him and defied the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own. Do you recall the tragic shooting at Columbine High School in Littleton, Colorado in 1999? Cassie Burnell declared her faith in God when asked if she believed, a decision that ended her life. Michael W. Smith wrote a song, This Is Your Time, and in his commentary, he said, for some of us, we can't say yes to the question, would you die for him? Because we've never really answered the question, will you live for him? If Jesus asked you, who do you say I am? How would you answer the question? Mark 8:29, Peter answered correctly, you are the Christ. Does your life look like a person who has faith in the God of the Bible? Do your actions reflect that you believe that God is sovereign, that he is in control, that he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? In a daily devotion titled Hope First, speaks when life catches you by surprise and you wonder if God is still with you. Remember this, we have a Father who will meet us where we are, wherever we are. The author wrote, one of Jesus' disciples experienced this firsthand after Jesus' resurrection. His name was Thomas, and he's more famously known as Doubting Thomas. After Jesus rose from the dead, he went to see the disciples. However, Thomas was absent. When the disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord," Thomas replied, "If I don't see the mark of the nails in his hands, put my finger into the mark of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I will never believe." Have you ever felt ashamed of your doubt? Thankfully, we have a Savior who doesn't judge us for our doubts or our mistakes. He hears us and is willing to show us that he is near at all times. In John 20, 26 through 29, a week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came in, stood among them, and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here, see my hands, reach out your hands and put it into my side. Don't be faithless, but believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus said, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. But blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." Jesus didn't have to go back to where the disciples were, but he did for the one, for Thomas. Jesus chose to meet Thomas where he was, and he will do the same for us. When we are struggling, when we're worried, when we're frustrated about our circumstances, we can tell God. We can we can cry out to God without fear of being judged, rejected, or abandoned. God wants us to confide in him because we are his children. No matter what we experienced or how far we drift, he will leave the 99 and meet us right where we are. How is your faith? Do you trust him in every circumstance? Do you have peace in chaos? Is the core of your being peaceful, serene, and confident? Isaiah 26:3, "You will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed on you." So how do we keep fixed on Jesus? Romans 12:2, "Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect." 2 Corinthians 5:17, "Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, a new life has begun." Wendy Pope, in a devotion titled "Wait and See," wrote, "Instead of strengthening my faith by tending to the sheep in my pasture and working out my salvation, I forged my idols." Her point is that we become impatient and try to rush the wait, especially when life hangs in the balance or our funds have run dry or our gas has run empty. We can't wrap our head or our heart around God's timing or his ways. When our pause seems more like a wilderness, we must be determined to strengthen our faith by trusting his timing. Cling to his peace and remember, God has a way of working miracles. In Jeremiah 29:11 through 14, if you want to turn there, if you do have your Bibles. Because one of my points is that this is our defense, our shield against any of the lies that we're going to hear. 29:11, "For I know the plans I have for you." "For I know the plans I have for you," declares the Lord, "plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me," and this is the kicker, "when you seek me with all your heart, I will be found by you," declares the Lord. God wants your whole heart. What areas of your life are you keeping for yourself, unwilling to surrender to God? Jeremy Camp wrote a song, "Christ in Me," that really reflects my heart, my desires. In this obsession with the things this world says makes us happy. Can't see the slaves we are in all the searching, all the grasping. So come and empty me, so it's you that I breathe. I want my life to be only Christ in me. So I will fix my eyes, because you're my source of life. I need the world to see that it's Christ in me. Done with what holds me down, the things I once was chasing after. Throw off those heavy chains that I have let become my master. So are you all in? In Revelations 3:16, Jesus says, so because you are lukewarm, neither hot or cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. Apathy, complacency, sitting on the sidelines. Sure, there's seasons of life that are more challenging. The last few years might be an example, but God wants us in the game. It's baseball season now, so what he wants to hear from us is, put me in, coach. I'm ready to play. He wants us in the game. In a daily devotion titled Transformed, it is said that every time we sin, it replaces a little bit of self-respect with a little bit of shame. This shame begins to pile up in our lives, and we begin to push it out of the way by staying busy, playing sports, getting drunk, going to parties, or whatever. For me, it's exercise. As you can see, it took a lot of work for me to get this body to where it is. I'm just kidding. My kids would say that's a dad's joke. They even bought me a mug that said, it's not a dad bod, it's a father figure. In Christ be magnified, the verse says, I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. Cody Carnes wrote, when I look at our culture today, it's clear to see that it's easy to get drifted away. To be formed by our feelings, to unknowingly let offense, shame, or anger drive our actions. Yet in the midst of this struggle, we always have an opportunity to hold fast to what is true in the Word of God. Tony Evans wrote in his devotion, Who Controls Your Thoughts?, stated that becoming who God wants you to be starts with your thoughts. Be mindful of the devil. Don't let him have free rein in your mind. Negative thoughts comes from Satan because they are all lies, and he is the father of lies. Satan makes quick work of planting thoughts and directing them. The key to overcoming him is to take your thoughts captive. Then the truth will set you free. God's word, his thoughts, the Bible are the truths that will counter Satan's lies and that will make you set free. This is our defense against the devil. It's his word. What are the lies that are holding you in bondage? The enemy tries to convince us that we are not worthy of love, that we can't be forgiven, and that no one really cares about where we are, what the struggles we're going through today. It's important to recognize this for what it is. It's a lie. Satan works through difficulty, accusations, and temptations to disengage us from the love of God. When we lose our awareness of God's constant love, it's because we fixed our eyes on a lie. The greatest reality and truth are that God is good and that he will always love us. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, no temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. James 1:2-4, consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and competent, not lacking anything. Deuteronomy 31:8. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. I recall when I was a young Christian, people in my Bible study would talk about backsliding. I wondered, how could you lose the desire to continue to seek and know him, to serve his kingdom? How does that happen? Christine Kane said, the only thing a person has to do to drift away is nothing. Proverbs 24, a sluggard does not plow in season, so at harvest time he looks but finds nothing. So, as I said, God wants us in the game. He wants all of us. We need to be fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ. Hebrews 2:1, we must listen very carefully to the truths we have heard, or we may drift away from it. Keep the word of God close in your heart. That will guard you against any of the lies that Satan will bring forward. When we drift away, this gives the devil the opportunity to feed the mind with false narratives. Rationalization is a lie when it contradicts the word of God. James 1:22, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourself. Do what it says. When I'm confronted with doing the right things, these are my verses. Micah 6:8, he has showed you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 through 18, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will in you in Christ Jesus. In what areas of your life do you find yourself rationalizing? How do these rationalizations, these obstacles, square with the truths of the Bible? If you know these areas, what are the truths that you hold on to contradict these lies? We must reject realization, those lies, and seek and know the truth, the word of God, the Bible. In 1 Peter 1, 13 through 16, it says, therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. Set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. My hope is that Christ will be magnified in all our lives, that we are all in and committed to the one true God, that our faith will never waver, that we will trust in God through the good times and the bad times, that we will identify those idols in our lives that are taking us away from worshiping Jesus and only Jesus, that we will seek the truth from the holy word of God through learning the scripture from the Bible. May our devotion and worship be focused on Jesus Christ, our Savior, who is the same today, yesterday, today, and tomorrow. In Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. John 16:33. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you, and my prayer is that we are all in for you, Lord, that we will live to the vision of being fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ, that we will seek your guidance, that we will look at your word, that we would put the shield up against the devil as he tries to take us away from you, Lord. So, Lord, I pray that we will all grow in faith, that we will just reject the idols that are in our life, that are taking us away from being fully fixed on your love and your grace, Lord. Lord, I ask that we are able to really spend time in your word to learn more about you, to get closer and closer to you, and to not be caught up in this world and the things that are going on, but to be focused on you and you alone. So I thank you for this opportunity. I thank you for this time. I lift up the whole congregation. I lift up the world, Lord, to you, and just ask that you look after us, that you continue to shepherd us, and thank you for always being there and never leaving us. We pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to leave you with a closing video song. If you don't know, I like videos and I like songs, and they kind of resonate what's kind of my thinking. So it really helps me to get these thoughts out. And this is by New Hope Oahu. It's called Future and a Hope. Thank you.
Our God is for us, greater with never forsaken. We have a promise. We have a future. Our God is for us, greater within us. We have a promise. We have a future.
Thank you, Craig, for sharing that with us. Let's take a moment now and reflect on what God has shared with each of us through Craig's message and consider how we might respond in the area of stewardship. For those of you who call Crossroads your home, let me remind you that there are offering baskets at the back of the church. For those of you who are online, you can send your offering to the church office or simply use the PushPay app. If you're just visiting with us this morning, please don't feel any obligation to put anything in the offering basket. We're just really grateful that you've chosen to spend your morning with us, so thank you for that. Let me just pray for the offering now. Father, thank you for your continuing generosity, your grace and mercy that you show to us every day. And Father, we want to ask your blessing on the offerings that will be given to you this day, this week, this month, and that they would reflect the trust that we have taken from the world and given to you. So thank you, Father, for all that you do for us. Receive these offerings to you this day. Thank you, Lord. Amen. And would you stand with me for the final worship song?
God in my living, there in my breathing, God in my waking, God in my sleeping, God in my resting, there in my working, God in my thinking, God in my speaking. Be my everything, be my everything, be my everything, be my everything. God in my hoping, there in my dreaming, God in my watching, God in my waiting, God in my laughing, there in my weeping, God in my hurting, God in my healing. Be my everything, be my everything, be my everything, be my everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. You are everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. You are everything. Be my everything. Thank you. in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. You are everything. 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 In Jesus, everything.
Thank you very much, worship team. Why don't you guys go ahead and please have a seat. I have a couple of important announcements to make. So first, we have a new photo directory that we've been working on. And to let you know, Ryan Takaguchi will be available next Sunday. That's July the 24th. And again, on Sunday, August the 21st, which is about a month later, to take pictures for that new photo directory. So if you guys need photos for that new photo directory, please make a note of that. He'll be here to take the pictures. He'll be here from after service to about noon thereabouts for picture taking. I also have an important update concerning Yoko Hayashida. So as many of you know, Yoko Hayashida was battling a second round of pancreatic cancer this past year. We have been blessed with Yoko for 16 years after her initial diagnosis. So Yoko went to be with our Lord Thursday night on July the 14th. Carol, Kevin, and Teresa was with her as she passed in the arms of our Lord. Yoko loved the Lord, loved the church, loved Crossroads, loved serving, and as very appropriate for Craig's message today, just loved memorizing scripture and used that scripture to just bless us so richly while she was here. And she loved praying for and interceding on all of our behalves. So we know that she is now enjoying her heavenly rewards and the full scope of communing with our Lord Jesus without the pain and weakness of the cancer in her body. So please pray for the Hayashida family during this transition. We'll have more information about any upcoming memorial services and so forth as they firm up. Right. I also have another update regarding our youth pastor, Pastor Rodney. So after 3 years with Crossroads commuting from San Diego, Pastor Rodney has decided to step down from the youth pastor position. Pastor Ronnie and Pastor Kevin and the Elder Board can acknowledge that connecting and developing relationships with the ASM students had become more challenging and difficult over the time. So Pastor Ronnie and his family wanted to really convey their thanks to Crossroads Community Church for the amazing opportunity to serve the families and the students here, and just wanted to know they will cherish their memories of this wonderful community. So please pray for the Perkins family as they make this transition. In the interim, the ASM will continue to meet as usual. The staff and the ASM leaders appreciate your support and patience as they work out a transition plan. You can feel free to contact me if you have any other specific questions about this as we have more details. So if you would bow your heads, I'd like to spend a few moments to pray for the Hayashida and the Perkins families. So, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for all that you bless us with. And as we often sing, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, Lord. And in good times and in difficult times, we say, blessed be your name. We want to lift up the Perkins family to you, Pastor Rodney, Christian, Krista, Christian, Heaven, and Zion. Lord, we thank you for Pastor Rodney and bringing him to the family of Crossroads and the lives that they were able to touch here. We thank you for Pastor Rodney's love of Scripture and his desire to serve you at every turn, Lord. And we ask that you grant the Perkins family peace and wisdom as they work through this next transition. And we thank you so much for how they've were able to bless Crossroads. And Lord, we want to give you thanks for Yoko Hayashida and for just giving us 16 wonderful additional years with her here. And through Yoko, you have impacted so many and blessed us here at Crossroads and far beyond, Lord. Yoko was and continues to be such an inspiration of faith, love, joy, thankfulness for so many. We just ask that you'd please wrap your arms around the whole Hayashida family, for Carol, Kevin, Teresa, Matthew, Michelle, Tim, Clifton, Jennifer, and their family, Lord. And we ask that you grant them peace, comfort, and just give them the many cherished memories of Yoko as she just served you. So thank you so much for all that you bless us with, Lord. And we thank you for your son, Jesus, and for the love and the ability to come before you white as snow. We thank you for these things. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So if you would go ahead and please stand with me for the benediction if you are able. So may the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you, and may the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord fill you with love, peace, and blessings today, tomorrow, and forevermore. Amen. Thank you very much.
I'm trading my sorrow.